Hello.
Hello.
Welcome to this. What is it? Third?
Third lecture, I think.
Yep.
Yeah. And welcome to you.
Oh, thank you. In the server-based web application. Server-based web programming course at Linz University. So this is the third lecture, and we had a peer instruction last week.
Yeah, in Växjö.
Yeah, we heard that some of you were on a boat somewhere.
I don't understand anything, but...
No, but I hope you are back, because we are kind of transitioning to the second part of the course and the second assignment. So this is a preparation for that.
I think we have three different lectures. That's the part two today and two more. And the assignment should be published on the course page by this morning, I think.
Yeah. What's the deadline for the first assignment?
You find it in the course webpage. I think it's Tuesday or Wednesday this week.
Yeah. So if you're already finished with the first assignment, please just dig in on the second one. And today we have the headline web application architecture.
Yeah.
We will be focusing on Express, the framework Express.
Yeah. We will start to build more web applications. In the first part, we discussed Node.
Okay, back.
Okay, some problems.
So the problem is we're like needing to connect to another studio to make this studio work, and hopefully in a week or two we will have a separate setup for this place, and it will work.
For those checking the recording, we will say we had some problem and double voice and stuff like that.
So we will try to restart and make a shorter version of what we just said.
Yeah.
So John is looking out in the Slack right now. So if it's still a problem, please write.
Yeah.
So in short, I think the sounds started to hiccup when we said what we were going to talk about today.
So we take it again.
Yeah. So basically, this is the content of today. We are going to talk about web application architecture and design.
Yeah.
Maybe not different architectural models, but seeing on a more big level on how web applications has arisen.
Yeah. And exactly. I think we said it before the sound broke down, that the first part of this course we were more talking about HTTP, the web, and you have done your web scraping, hopefully, and stuff like that. Now we're going to talk more about doing web applications, typical web applications. And the first part will be about web application architecture and more design, code structure, and stuff like that. So that's a more general and more general model of web applications. And then we're going to talk about Express.js.
Looking at specific topics in Express like middleware and how routing is handled.
The later part will be a pretty hands-on stuff.
Pretty hands-on for the assignment 2 as well, because that is more or less what assignment 2 is about.
Yeah, exactly. And I think we're going to have 3 lectures in this part. This one, and next we're going to talk about databases, persistence, and we're going to talk about security, web security as a third part.
Yeah. So moving on to the content of the day, and first of all, the web is quite a new technology, more or less. It's been around since the 90s, we are still more or less in the era where we are trying to find the optimal doing stuff.
And during the years, it has changed a lot, though. Yeah. So
going back to the 90s, when I started doing web development, and there was static HTML in the beginning in like 97, 96, 97, something like that. And back then, JavaScript was just introduced in the browser as a programming language in the browser, but in the beginning, for the first like 10 years, it was mainly used for doing simple things like animating text and validating forms and things
blinking
like that.
Blinking text.
Yeah,
stuff.
Blinking text. So there was a need for some kind of other technique to create web applications, and Java applets, for instance, was one of them, those techniques that were supposed to. I mean, being able to run Java in the browser was seen as the thing to do, more or less.
As a plugin who get more
privileges.
Yeah, work with the file system, work with the Java libraries and stuff like that.
Yeah. So back then, a lot of functionality was basically put in the browser.
Yeah, in applets or in Flash, maybe. Or not maybe
back in the
way
day
back then, but where.
Yeah. And a problem with that is browser incompatibility.
Yeah.
Java applet in the browser wasn't a good platform.
The clients are so many and so different and have a different kind of CPUs and memory and stuff like that. So that's probably pretty hard to get consistency.
Yeah, so coders try to, so the client is hostile. As we said, or as Crockford said, so it's a hostile environment. So if we go back to the server, we could have a more controlled environment, and a lot of developers starting using techniques on the server instead for applications, making it so that the server only renders views and sending static HTML to the client.
Exactly. So the static HTML views were coming back to the client.
Yeah. And we got techniques like this CGI with...
Yeah, more like a term of different kind of languages. That could be C or C++ or
modules
Python,
running on the
Perl,
yeah.
stuff like that.
Yeah, so models running on the web server doing things. And later on, we got techniques like PHP, ASP.NET from Microsoft.
That we used a lot today also.
Yeah.
And for many web developers, PHP maybe is the first... server script technique you have used, because it's common, it's free, it's easy to install, it's easy to test, and lots of web servers or web hotels have support for PHP.
Yeah, and I mean that was the state in the early 21st century, being running PHP pages more or less, and JavaScript was still this kind of bad sibling that you had in the browser, the black sheep.
Yeah, just a little client script language.
Yeah, and more or less seen as an unsecure thing.
Yeah, you didn't do stuff with it.
but then things happened. Gareth James wrote the article about Ajax, introducing Ajax. It's been there in the browser, or at least in Internet Explorer since early days. But we got a way of updating the client from the server using Ajax. And asynchronous information.
And get it look more like desktop applications in a way.
And now we are in 2006, something like that, or the era of 2006. And then, once again, I mean, the applications, they moved to the server. But back when we are in 2006, 2007, the browser vendors are working together, finally making supporting web standards.
Yeah.
Not in different ways, in the same way, not supporting them all, but those that they support, they are doing it in the same way. So once again, it becomes nicer to have the application running in the browser, as you said, mimicking the desktop environment. And so developers started to more or less add the functionality to the browser back again. So we have applications today running mainly in the browser with some server, and more or less just looking at the server as a data layer.
Yeah, exactly. So the client asks for data on the server and present it, and take care of the data in a more advanced way than we were used to before.
Yeah, and later on, or right now, you can all say we have this environment where we are writing web APIs. Working with real-time applications, we will use real-time.
In the last part of this course, we will look at real-time technologies like WebSockets, and we're going to talk about webhooks and stuff like that, that we call real-time technologies.
Yeah, and those technologies or those concepts, they push the technology forward.
Yeah.
Because, maybe PHP isn't the best technology to handle real-time applications, for instance.
No.
And I mean, now we got Node, for instance, that is good at handling.
And one thing, as we say, the web changes, but also more and more companies want to bring their applications that was a desktop application with lots of things, and now we can do these things with web technologies. We can put them on the web and make changes to the application more frequently and stuff like that. And that pushes the web using this kind of technologies. We need the real-time technology. We just need to send data from the server to the client and stuff like that. And of course, it's more complex to write this kind of application. You probably will get problems with number of users. You have a lot and lot and lot of requests, so you're gonna think about how to scale your server, how to update, how to bring more hardware, or to split the application in different servers and stuff like that. So it has changed the web and the web developing stuff a lot this last 5-10 years.
Yeah, and since the web has evolved and developed and matured, we now see that, I mean, desktop applications are being written using web technologies. So it's more or less the opposite. I mean, before, a classic desktop application was this like contained environment where you just wrote stuff and you didn't have any communication without more or less more than saving files.
Yeah.
And then you had to take this file, send by email to someone and just start. But I mean, with the web and collaboration, we want to have those technologies in desktop applications as well. And then we have the web technology because we have solved a lot of problems using like sockets and things and real-time communication. So we are in a stage where like web technology is getting everywhere into phones, into desktop applications. Web of Things is something that is, I mean, we have talked about the Internet of Things.
So yeah, that's a common term, Internet of Things. And we're talking about devices getting connected to each other. We can do lots of stuff, connecting your car, connecting your whatever thing. The problem with Internet of Things could still be that, okay, we buy a device from a company which has its own protocol, its own application to use to connect to the device and stuff like that. So you see a lot of research or a lot of communities trying to, just as Tim Berners-Lee took the internet protocols and put the web application layer upon it, we're talking about Web of Things, where you have this Internet of Things, but put the web standard, web technologies to use to, in a more easy way, get different kind of devices to connect to each other and talk to each other in a more standard way, and using web technologies and web standards, which is
will become a huge area.
We think so. It's very interesting to follow.
That's just showing where we are today.
Yeah.
And looking at web application architecture, we have this quote: "Developers using the right architecture will naturally fall in a pit of success." So this is more. I mean, I think you guys have read like a lot of architectural courses with maybe Jesper and so you are probably more experts on software architecture than we are, but
the thing is we from the start the web was pretty simple, the web application wasn't so complex, but as we showed how it's mature and we're doing more complex thing, we need to talk about web application architecture. And we will not go into great detail, but we're going to show some of the more common way to handle it.
Mm. Yeah, so let's get to it. So I think this dividing it like this is something we did. But you can see a web application like looking at those those dots. We have the physical and system architecture, and, and I mean that's a big area, and nothing that we will cover in this course.
No, but well, we the last part we're going to talk something about production, so more to this. But as we talked about the one thing that's very hard when talking about web application is scaling. Because when we're talking desk application, we only have one user and stuff like that. In this case, we could have very many requests in the same time. How can we handle our application server can't break down? We need to get to handle all these requests. Mm. And you have different technologies to architecture the system to handle this. Scaling and stuff like that.
And I mean, choices we make on the physical system architectural level will somehow affect how we write our code. Yeah. If we are like looking at things like microservices or whatever, it will affect even the software architecture.
Yeah, I think as the role as a web developer, you have to have some kinds of idea of this. Things we talking about the DevOps term, where the developer and the ops person get together and have knowledge of all these kinds. I think as a web developer, you need to have you need to know how to set up a Ubuntu server to run your applications and stuff like that, and have some idea about hardware and virtualization and monitoring and stuff like that. Mm.
Going over to the software architecture, I mean that is something that you have probably read in many courses, I mean, looking at the architecture for Java, for instance, we will look at some basic patterns and how to do things. Because, I mean, just because we are on the web doesn't mean that the software architecture will completely change. You will probably recognize a lot of the concepts behind software architecture even for the web, and I mean. Model view controller, for instance, that we'll talk about is inspired.
Design patterns and stuff.
Yeah,
like that.
That's been around since the 70s, so nothing new there. But so we will focus on software architecture today. Something that we will talk about next week is data architecture.
Yeah, handling data. Maybe we don't get into details, just the architecture stuff, but we're going to talk about persistent data.
Yeah. And I know many of you are taking the database theory course right now, so that's a touching point. And information architecture, and that is on a higher level.
That is how the organization is handling the information and stuff like that. We don't. Well,
we will maybe. I mean, when we are designing our APIs, for instance, have the business model come shining through, but we will not focus on that in this course. So starting from the beginning with classic
We talked about this in some way.
Yeah.
What to bring on the browser or the client, or what to bring on the server.
Yeah. And this is called a two-tier architecture.
Yeah, you can call it
where you have like the server and the browser. And
sometimes you talk about theory, but sometimes you talk about layer.
Tiers and layers. Yeah. And we've talked about thin clients or fat clients, and that is basically the upper one is the thin client, where everything is happening on the web server, and the lower one is the fat client, where we have more happening on the client, and I mean in most cases the truth is somewhere in between.
The hype is pending.
Sometimes
I talk about thin clients, and sometimes it's good to have thick clients or fat clients.
So that's basically the two-tier architecture. So moving on to three-tier architecture, it's more or less the same as the two-tier, just that we are separating the data.
We should be able to change the data management, the database server, and try to separate our code from that, so we don't have it in the same layers. So one of the first architecture that you were using when writing web applications was this three-tier architecture.
Yep.
Trying to separate up the business logic and separate it from the database
yep.
management.
Yep. And this term below here, CRUD, the CRUD or CRUD. Mm-hmm. It's a basic pattern for web applications. It means it means that you have an application that you can create resources, you can read resources, you can update resources, and you can delete yeah. resources. So you can think of a blog system. It's a typical yeah. CRUD application where you could like add posts or member registry or whatever.
And that's the main thing we're gonna do in the assignment. We're gonna do a CRUD application. Mm. With some security stuff, with a authentication system
yeah.
upon on, but that's the classical web application.
Yeah, which have been, I mean, been done in PHP and ASP.NET
yeah.
forever. So
yeah.
so nothing new there. But we are doing it in Node. But I mean, for those types of applications, I mean, more or less whatever technique you choose is good enough.
Mm.
I mean. Yeah, so we have this, I mean, when we divide it like this in tiers, we can scale things easier. We can, I mean, this could be the case that, okay, so the data management isn't the problem in our application. The problem is handling a lot of requests and
yeah.
and the business logic is taking time. And then we could do this horizontal scaling,
yeah.
adding the business logic to several servers, and each server is handling with a load balancer, handling the requests and using the same data yeah. management.
Instead of just buying more CPUs
yeah.
or
yeah.
bigger server, we can divide the code into
yeah.
one layer and spread it out on different servers and handle that. And as you said, it's easier to do it. Maybe the database management it isn't the bottleneck in the application, so we can use this architecture for scaling also.
Yeah. And vertical scaling, just to be specific, was what you said, just adding more memory
exactly.
and CPUs. Yeah. So after that, we have the N-tier architecture. So, I mean, N standing for whatever
yeah.
layers you like, more or less.
Of course, we could add more layers. You probably, not just the business logic, we can separate code
yeah.
more and add more layers.
Just to make it easier to make the code and or to
handle changes.
Yeah.
We in some layer we're gonna switch out some technology or stuff like that, so we don't have to update code in the other layer, so we can separation of concern of
yeah.
course.
So this is just an example, but a pretty common example that we have a data access layer talking to the database. So ideally, if we are using a SQL Server database, we don't need to change much. We can change the data management system without more or less altering the data access layer. But if we are changing altogether, adding a document database,
yeah.
we will probably have to do a lot
yeah.
of changes.
But it
to
shouldn't
the
have anything to do
with
the business
logic or presentation.
No, exactly,
yeah.
so we can maintain that code.
And
yeah. Yeah, we were talking scaling. We can do it in different layers in this architecture.
Yeah, and we have the presentation and on top, probably being written in some kind of template engine that we have a lot of HTML in. So instead of mixing, I mean, it's the same thing, principle more or less, that we talked on the client. That's try to avoid to mix up, for instance, JavaScript with HTML. Okay, so, and we add this one, microservice architecture. This is also a architecture that has been around for quite a while, but the later years
yeah.
has been, I mean, seeing a lot of getting a lot of
you
error.
Have talked about service oriented Archer pretty long, but the problem was it got a lot of enterprise. We had the web service term or the web service standard, which many uses today, and lots of money and lots of code is put into that technology. But it got pretty hard to work with. The REST API and the RESTful thinking came as an alternative to the SOA development. And nowadays we're talking about microservices, like, so it's the service-oriented thinking about it, but done right, more simple, more light than most of the web service community did.
So basically it's like, okay, so we have this, think of this as a big application with a lot of business logic doing everything, like,
yeah, the application
handling
is the
members, handling posts, handling a lot of different kinds of data. So this is the monolithic big web application with a giant data management in the bottom. So microservices, the thinking, just splitting up.
Define different smaller services, add them on different servers. You can use REST APIs, calling them, getting data back and forth, and try to split up the bigger monolithic applications into different smaller services that can be used in a more flexible way.
Yeah, and scaling is a big thing here as well.
Because,
I mean, having it like this, it makes it so simple to just scale parts of the application that is, or part of the system that is the bottleneck.
And it's a lot of talk about microservices
right now.
So if you try to find some articles about it, you will probably find a lot of people writing about microservices now. We're not gonna go into it in this course, but it's a good term to have come upon.
So getting down to business, so we could have a look at, I mean, this was just talking about the different tiers and stuff. We are going to be somewhat more concrete now and look how to organize our code, because that is what we are going to talk about next. And this is a classical M-tier application.
ASP.NET
looks like.
Yeah.
Split up in the DHL, the data access layer, the BLL for the business logic layer. So they are basically separate folders in the application. And we have the view engine as well. It's this one in the middle. So this is just a representation of that. I'm not sure if we are anything more to say about this.
No, it's just to show you how, when going from architectural talking to code structure, this is how an entire application could look like. You try to separate up in different projects on different folders or stuff like that, like this.
A popular technique for I mean, writing web applications today, or pattern, is the model view controller pattern, MVC pattern. And you have probably, and please tell us in the Slack channel, you have probably used the MVC pattern in other courses and in other techniques before, so you are probably familiar with dividing applications with a model and the view and the controller. And I mean, this is not a new pattern, it's been around since the 70s.
When it came, it was for desktop applications, but it's a very good design pattern when talking about...
Yeah, it's been proven to be pretty good. However, I mean, there are different... I mean, the pattern has been adopted by web developers and web frameworks, and there is a lot of talk if this is the right way of handling, but it's a big paradigm, and... it's used in a lot of frameworks. So
And the framework we are going to talk about is influenced by the MVC design pattern. So that's why we introduce it here.
Yeah. And as you write the last point, it's not a contrast in contrast to the N-tier architecture. I
mean, no, it's just this is more defining design pattern or code structure. Yeah. So the entire is more architecture.
Yeah. Okay, so this is just a picture of, I will remove ourselves. this is just a picture of MVC for the server. So the server is below the black line, and we have the browser at the top, and we have a controller that is responding to or taking the requests.
Handling the
requests and just using the module down below for fetching data.
Yeah,
and
probably some connection to the database and all stuff. Validating the data, maybe also.
Collecting the data and with the view, combining it with a view and sending a result back to the browser. That is pretty much it. And this is, I mean, as I said, there has been a lot of talk about this. Is MVC the right thing for the web? And there has been a lot of surrounding the controller, what is the purpose of the controller, what is the responsibilities for the controller. So it has been changed around a lot, and different takes on the MVC pattern has arisen.
Yeah, you will find model view model. What's MTV is model template view. I think a Python framework called Django is using model view presentation. So it's when you read about these design patterns and talking about web application, you will find many different kinds of. The one we're going to use, express.js, well, it's not exactly an MVC.
It's a model view router.
model view router middleware,
yeah,
stuff like that.
Yeah.
So, but the main...
The thoughts, the concepts is more or less the same. So,
so we need to know what MVC is.
Yeah. So, and this is just, to show, we are at the server. We will talk about the server using Express. And in Express, as we said, you might not have the controller specified as a controller. You have it more or less like a router instead, just routing the requests to the controller code, combining it.
Yeah, and many, like Ruby on Rails, you also have a routing. The way you define your routes, your URLs, and then sending it back to sending it to the controller.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, and as we said, I mean, we are writing applications both on the server and on the client, and this has led to something called isomorphic JavaScript. I'm not sure about the status right now, but
it was pretty hot in a couple of years, but I don't know.
So the thought was more or less, okay, so if we have the view and the model and the controller on the server, why not have the same code run at the client? So we can have an application that will, if needed, run on the server and being able to run on the client as well, and taking advantage of using the same model classes, for instance, or using a lot
it's
of
a bit confusing.
it is. And I mean, the standard right now is to just write more or less writing APIs on the server and having a richer client with written in like Angular, which is a model.
But the clients use these design patterns also.
Yeah.
So you, the MVC pattern or model view model, I think Angular is using, for example.
Yeah.
So you the design patterns could also be used in more advanced web frameworks on the client also.
Yeah. And we have other frameworks as well on the client that is not maybe utilizing MVC directly, like React, who has this flux model with the flow control and stuff. So I mean, still have two, it's two different topics, the client and the server still. But who knows? I mean, the isomorphic JavaScript still opens for some kind of applications running on both client and server.
Yeah.
Who knows? what to remember before the break, I guess.
Exactly.
When applications grow, we need structure. Yeah. And that is probably something that you have learned in the architectural courses if you...
Yeah, we have to separate things. We have to know where to change, so we have some kind of structure or code, because the applications is getting more and more complex.
Yeah.
You can't just do one PHP file and and handle everything in that.
Well, you could but not for bigger applications. No. But I mean, it's still useful to. I mean, we say it sometimes that students are, if we give a pretty simple task, like just scrape this page to get the phone numbers out. Some start writing those big MVC applications with databases and stuff. Why? You could just write like a simple script, just scraping to get a job done. So I mean, you need to also think about what kind of application you are writing.
Yeah. Web scraping script is one example of where we maybe just have one file, or we don't need a MVC framework. That's correct, of course.
To be clear, it's not to punish you who might have written an MVC thing for the first assignment. That's good, but I'm just saying that sometimes it's like, shooting mosquitoes with cannons, or what do we say in Swedish?
Yeah.
I'm not sure if that translates. Skjuta mygg med haubits, så säger
jag. It's the Swedish thing.
Yeah. As we said, express.js is inspired by the MVC.
And we're going to talk about Express in the next, after the break.
So
this was just a more general explanation of web applications architecture.
So hopefully my buttons will work and we can have like 10 minutes break. I think we will settle with 10 minutes because we have a demo at the end, and that's kind of always take some time. So 10 minutes break and we will continue after that.
Ha, 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 ha.
kunde bli så. Ja, men det måste ju vara att det här ljudet loopades ut.
Ja, jag vet inte.
För att jag hade väl... Ja, nu tryckte jag av det. Så när jag satte i HDMI-in, även om jag hade ljudet av, när jag satte i HDMI-in så tog den ut det här ljudet.
Vad fan händer nu?
What?
Oj, vi ligger live.
Are we live? Det där är ju skitkult. So
we are back.
Yep.
Again.
A lot of ghostery going on with the systems, but we got some questions on live coding, so we thought we should address them. First of all, this thing about exchanging databases in applications.
It sounded easier than it is, maybe.
As someone said, that have never come to that. I mean, you often base your architecture, or you get so involved in those technologies, so changing the database is not just like taking it out and inserting another one. Mm. I actually did that once, going from SQL Server to MySQL. I think it was that way.
How was that?
Or was it the other way around? I don't remember. But actually, it was just the connection string I had to change in that application, and it, thank God, worked, because...
Well, you should be able to do it, so it's good to have some architecture that supports it, but maybe
so that application wasn't extremely large, but I mean, it had a couple of thousand users or something like that, so but it worked anyway. It's not that easy, basically. There were some kind of questions that we didn't understand, so I will skip them. Okay, going back to content. So we are going to dive into Express.js now. And Express is the framework for Node, basically.
Yeah, and you can call it a default framework. When talking about Node.js, often you come across Express.js as a default framework for web architecture. But it's not the only one. The Node platform is pretty young, so... more frameworks coming for the day. Could say you have a lot of different frameworks like Koa, Happy, Sales, JS, and so. So it's not the only one, but it's the one we have chosen to use in this course.
Mm. And the problem we are solving, why are we using the framework? Why just not write the code in
Because, of course, it helps us writing CRUD application, using routes, having URLs answering, handling the request, the response, separating our code in a good way.
Hmm.
So it of
helps
course,
us with...
Why do we use frameworks? Because they do the boring thing for us.
Yeah.
If we would write this code every time... we would be pretty bored with writing web applications. So the framework helps us with that.
Yeah. So I mean, this is not a course about Express.js, but we will use it just to get further quicker, more or less. And I mean, if we start writing bare-bone JavaScript in Node, we will soon find out that we are going to start writing helper functions for doing things, and those functions will pretty soon lead up to some kind of library, and this library will become a framework. Yeah. So we will end up in maybe not Express way of doing things, but a framework more or less in the end, probably.
Yeah.
So starting off with a framework is not a bad idea, I think. So we will talk about those concepts like middleware soon. So the second assignment, it's a CRUD application. What could we say about it?
Yeah, we have published it on the course page. It will be a CRUD application with persistent data, so we're gonna use MongoDB. I think we have a Vagrant file for those who don't want to install all the stuff on your local machines. So we have a Vagrant image or Vagrant file installing Node, MongoDB, and stuff like that.
And it's optional.
Yeah, it's optional. You can do it on your own if you want. Mm. We're also going to have security in mind. We're going to talk about different kind of security issues when talking about web application later on, how to CSurf attack, stuff like that, how to build your authorization system.
Storing the credentials.
Yeah. So it will be with security in mind, this assignment. But you can read it up. It's on the course page.
Yep. Okay, so diving into to express.js, the first we will notice is how we will structure our file, and we will structure those files with MVC in mind. And there's, I mean, Express is not telling you to do it like this. So you can write, there is a template, you can generate templates, Express templates, and they will somewhat tell you how you could do things. Yeah, we will not use that.
I think they have some scaffolding tools inside, but we don't think we will use that or enforce that.
No, but Express will not tell you how to organize your files. It's up to you to organize them in a good way.
And there are different ways to do it. Yeah. We have a link on this slide, so you can check up different kind of ways to structure your code, how to name your folders and stuff like that. And maybe you find your own opinion. We have one we are going to use in our examples
that you are free to. I mean, as long as you are consistent in what you're doing, so you're not just like putting views and controller code and business logic just mixed together in a big pile.
No.
So have some kind of clear thought about how you want to do it. And if you don't have a known fault, you could always
to defend it on the examination.
So you need to know why you did how you did. So this is more or less the approach we will go for in this course, and it's a pretty easy approach. We can see that in this we have the package.json,
and the node modules.
And the node modules generated when we do an npm install. Then we have the server.js, if you want to name it server.js, app.js, index.js.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the starting point of the application.
It's
anyway.
The file we will start with the node command.
Yeah, and it should probably be specified in the package.json as well, that this is the starting file. We have the views. So in the views, we have template code.
We're going to talk about templates in a minute. The things that generate the HTML, the presentation for the client.
Yeah. We have the model library where we store the models or the code for accessing or the models and their accessing databases, for instance.
Which we're going to talk more about the
next
lecture.
We have the routes, and this we will talk about soon. And this is just more or less the controller code in this case, telling the applications what to do when. We have the lib. I'm jumping up and down, but we have the libs folder, and this is for most dependencies on our applications will end up in the node modules because they will probably be node modules. But we can have other helper code that is not.
Yeah, maybe we write some own module or internal module or helper functions and stuff like that. We can
place it in the libs.
Yeah,
the config is for configuration files, configuring.
Yeah.
When
you work, you will have different environments. You will work in the development environment or the test where you write all your tests, and maybe you have a different database or different kind of configurations for these different environments. And the config, I use it for specifying this, and then when I start the application, I tell run it in test environment, and then all the configs for the test, the database for the test, and stuff is defined in the config.
In the config folder, there might be files that you don't want to or want to handle carefully when like using GitHub, for instance.
Remember if you're using some credentials and stuff like that. Put it in the git ignore so you don't push it up on GitHub.
It's private repos, but you never know. I mean,
And sometimes we need to have the credentials. So, when you go and make a public repository stuff like that, think about what you put and what you.
this is a side note, but I've seen it before with students adding. Having the credentials in the application, having it in private repos on GitHub, for instance. And then they are thinking, oh, I need to make this public. So I will remove the credentials and do a commit. And the problem with that is that if you just make the repository public, you will still have the history.
Yeah.
So you could, I mean, look in the history. So you need to take that in consideration as well.
The only thing to do when you, it's to change the credentials. So it's easy to do wrong. You just push it up and
forget to put it
in the Git ignore file.
Okay, so the last one, the public. This is the folder where you put all your static resources that is not needed to be parsed dynamically.
Because express.js, you can put that folder out and say, okay, this is just an image, it's just a CSS. You don't have to go through all the stuff the framework are doing. Just get the resource and send it back.
Yeah. So. Are we placing JavaScript in the public folder?
Yeah.
Yeah. And that is client JavaScript.
Yeah, of course.
When you ask like that.
So I mean, images, style sheets, static HTML files, static and JavaScripts that are meant for the client.
The things we could put on our CDN.
Yeah. Okay, going over to routes then, and the URL mapping. I mean, this comes down to going back in time. Do we have an example? Yeah, we have an example here. So back when I wrote a lot of PHP applications, it was really, really used. You could see like example.com/users/getuser.php %id=537 to get to that user. And I mean, that was because it was the easy thing to do in PHP out of the box. I mean, there were plugins for Apache to have nicer URLs, but
yeah, you have to write it up in a config file, and most web developers didn't do that.
But today it's more or less you should always hide like the implementation details, and you should just think of the URLs as something that should be more or less beautiful to watch.
You shouldn't have the file extensions and stuff like that.
So you should more or less look at what is this resource, what's the purpose of this resource, and have a URL that matches that. And we will get into, I guess, talking a little bit about REST APIs as well and how you construct
REST
APIs.
Well, that's very important because you address a resource.
Yeah. So talking about URLs, keep it simple, be consistent. Don't like mix users, and sometimes if the users are students, they are called students and users, and mix things around. Be as consistent as you can, even if you have several resources. I mean, if you have a students/add for adding students, you could have a message/add for adding messages to your application. So that your consistency throughout the API or the because the URLs are an API for people using, and for you using your own application. Hyphens versus underscores, what's your take on that?
Hyphens.
Yeah.
Yeah. I have to remember what it meant.
So when you're dividing, don't use, of course, blank spaces, because that will break. It will not look that good. Use hyphens instead to separate words. Underscores are, I mean, the reason I think why underscores are not seen as good to use is it will be problematic in print, and it will be problematic, because browsers are underlining URLs.
Hard to see.
It could be hard to see the underscores. So hyphens is more or less the standard today. Use all lowercase, no mixing of lower and uppercase.
You could have different kind of servers. Yep. So I don't think Windows look at it as Unix servers.
As I remember, IIS is not case sensitive, and Unix and Linux servers.
So always use lowercase. Yep.
And I mean, this is important for SEO, for search engine optimizations. Having addresses or URLs that speak to you is a good thing for SEO as well. So you will get benefited by doing that, and it will be easier to understand your application as well. So how do we do it? First of all, we are going to talk about HTTP verbs, and we touched upon this in several lectures, basically. But this is an example of how you can construct a user API or a user.
Yeah, you're using the URL to tell what the resource is. And since you have the different verbs, you also tell the action. So get / users, you will getting a list of all users. That's the main thing. We have post to users.
To the same resource?
Yeah, to the same URL, but we're sending the post this time, telling that we want to create a user.
Mm. So in our application, we are listening for all calls to the user's URL. And depending on if it's a get or it's a post, we will do different things. And since we have the put and delete as well, in our,
we could use that and specify a specific user with the ID to put to update or edit the user, and delete, of course, to delete the user. And this, when we're talking about RESTful web APIs, this is the standard way of thinking about different resources, using these verbs, the HTTP methods. But we have a problem when we're talking about...
Yeah, and when we're talking about client-side applications, basically, because HTML forms are not supporting more than get and post.
Yeah.
And since they are, we cannot send a post with delete or put.
No.
We need another way of doing this.
Yeah, we had to do it through Ajax. We could do it, but when using forms, HTML forms, we can't. So we have to take another view on this.
Yeah. So let's look at that. So this is a more complex view maybe, but it's only utilizing get and post. So we need to have more descriptive URLs. We need in the URL to say more than the resource. We need to say what we will do with the resource.
And this go against the RESTful thinking because you shouldn't use the URL, it's just addressing stuff, and the HTTP method is telling what to do.
Yeah.
But we have to do it, and okay, you can solve it in other ways, but
we recommend this way. As you said, you can use, you can handle all form interaction in the browser using Ajax, for instance, and you will get around it. But then you could have problems with users switching off if you only have a simple web page with a contact form, you will probably want that contact form to work without JavaScript. If you have a rich application, then, well, it will not work anyway, so... So looking at the get first, those two. The first one is the same as the last one, but in this case we have added the. We could have done that in the other one as well.
Yeah, I just think we.
Yeah, so if we send just like get users and like 5937, we will get that specific user, if it's a username or whatever.
That's the same in the prior.
But this one is another way of doing it. So instead of posting we are posting, instead of posting to users, we are posting to users/create. If we first of all sends a get to the users/create, we will get a form back in HTML.
We must do a request to get the form first, of course. So we have the /create URL. And then when we get the form, filling the form, doing the client validation if needed, then we send a post to the same URL telling, okay, here's the data, create the user.
Yeah.
In this case.
Yeah, and we are doing the same with editing. So instead of doing put, we are getting user/edit and the ID of the user.
Yeah. And then we get a form with pre-filled in the data that the user currently have.
Yeah, and we change
that
and post to the same URL. Same thing with delete.
We should. Okay, you can just post directly, but you should have some confirmation before you delete stuff.
Yeah. So this is basically the concept we will work after.
Code.
Yay, code. First off, we are going to use Express. So we need to of course install Express, adding it to the package JSON as we talked about before, and we are just instantiating or calling this as Express. We have require.
Yeah,
Express.
We should have some require stuff above this, but you know all about that.
Yeah. And we get this app object back, and it's on this app object we could work from now on.
Yeah.
And it's quite simple. I mean, in this case, we have the app.get method. So the get method will be called when we get a get. And as the first argument, we will specify what URL we are listening for with this specific get request. And in this case, we will listen for messages and with a specific ID.
Yeah. And we have colon ID.
Yeah.
Which tells us it's dynamic. So if the user writes /123,
this one will be 123.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So this will be replaced. We will see that below. And we have a callback function, just as we have seen in Node, with a request and a response. So we get. We can use the request and response.
The request will have information about the request headers and stuff like that, all things we need to know, and the response we can fill with information and send it back.
Yeah, as you've shown in the demo.
Yeah, exactly.
And as a bonus, we get, if we write request.params, we will get parameters sent in this way, like the ID, for instance.
Yeah, it will be mapped to that.
Yeah. And we have a post for the same URL, more or less. So when we post to messages, it will end up here, and we could save this data or do whatever we like. So it's pretty straightforward.
This is how we define our routes or our URLs.
Yeah. Nothing more to say about that, I think. But this is an important concept when it comes to understanding Express.
Yeah.
And it's the concept of middlewares.
Mm.
So it's basically that you could insert code that will be run in a chain when the request comes to the server. So we call those middlewares.
Yeah.
Following the middleware pattern, I guess. So you can, for instance, you can have a middleware adding session handling. You can have a middleware injecting something into the request that we can have use for later on.
From that, we get the request to we send a respond, that we can add different kinds of functionality in a middleware, so we separate them, so we don't do it in one big function. So we can, as you said, we could log stuff. We can manage session, we can add security, we can parse the data in a good way, as I think we will see in the next slide. Yeah. So by adding middleware functionality, we can do things with the request and the response on the way.
Yeah, and It's important to understand that when we are adding, we will add a lot of callback functions. Those callback functions will be executed in an order, in the order they are defined.
Yeah.
So if we have three different callback functions or middlewares, they will hopefully be called in order, but you could break the chain by not calling next. So when we look at the middleware, we will have this next point or function that we can run, and that will execute the next middleware in
you
the chain.
Send it further on in the chain with
and
the next.
You can stop the chain by not sending a next.
Or sending a respond back, because when we do respond.send, for instance, you just send it back to the client and the chain is broken.
Yeah, it will not. If you still continue to write next, it will continue to chain, but you will probably... I mean, you could do that. I mean, it's possible that you want to send the response to the server and then do something. Response back to the client and then do something, like logging or whatever. Mm. You can do that, but I think the normal way is that you, as you said, when you send a response, you don't do a next, and then the chain is broken, because later down the chain you will probably have some kind of 404 page showing.
We will see.
And that would be a problem if we continue to chain the next. But let's look at an example. And in this case, we have the cookie parser middleware. for parsing cookies.
Yeah, what you could say is express.js is trying to be as lightweight as possible. So much of the functionality you have to require different modules to put in this middleware chain.
Yeah.
I think from the beginning they have much of this body parser and stuff like that built into the framework, but more and more you will see you have to do a require on a body parser module and add it as we see here to put it in the middleware chain.
Yeah.
So you probably, if you find some older articles, you could find where you don't have to do this require on
body parser, for instance.
Yeah, exactly.
Because it was built in. Okay, so the body parser in this case is also doing what it says. So that's good naming.
Yeah.
But it's parsing the body. So if, for instance, you have JSON sent to you, you can use the body parser to get the JSON data.
Yeah, in this case, you if you write a web API, you're getting JSON from the client, so you have to parse it so you can work with it in a good way in your Express application. So in this case, we're calling the .json function. If you're using HTML forms and stuff like that, you have to parse that data in kind of way, and then you use another call.
I think we have I don't remember that as well, but. Yeah, so basically to adding a middleware to the chain, you're using the app.use.
Mm.
So we are registering the middleware by calling use. And use wants a function. What's it called? A function reference.
Okay.
So but this doesn't look like a function reference because we are calling the function, right?
Mm.
But in this case, the cookie parser will return a function that is meant for app.use. Mm. So you need to kind of look in the documentation, because often you need to do it like this, that you call a function that returns a function, but in some cases you will just send a function
reference to the user. And that's a problem when you have third party stuff.
Yeah. So beware. But, but the use wants a function reference anyway.
But probably when you're writing an Express application, you had a long list of this middleware stuff, handling security stuff and stuff. So be prepared for that.
Yeah. Okay, so we can of course add our own middlewares, and we have already seen how to do that by for instance adding a get middleware, and the upper in the upper case we are telling that we want the middleware on the get chain, and this middleware will listen for gets on the slash messages URL. And when a request comes in that fulfills this, I mean, that it is a get and it is meant for messages, we will call this callback function, which with has the request, the response, and this the next pointer. Yeah. So we get the function sent to us, the next function, and we are supposed to call that function when we are done.
Yeah. To send it further on in the chain.
Yeah. However, as you said, if you are doing a response send, so you're sending something back in the response, you will probably not call next.
No.
In this
case. As we seen in the when we defined the URL, we didn't have the next in the parameter list. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, and we have a get and a use, and use listen to all the requests, post, delete, put. So if we want to log something and we just don't want to listen to the get or post, or so we can do app.use. It will listen to all different methods to slash messages in this case.
Yeah. So I mean, when we called it like this, without a URL in the use as the first parameter, then it will listen on everything. For every request to the application, the cookie parser will be called as a middleware. Mm-hmm. But in this case, when we are adding the first attribute with a string, it will parse only calls to that.
So we can specify exactly as we want.
And you have the app.all as well, right? You have an app.all that does more or less the same thing, but I think there are edge cases that are not handled in the same way, but you will probably use use.
That's a homework to check up in the documentation. Exactly.
So error handling, I mentioned before that, I mean, in an application, if the user writes an URL that is not valid, the user should probably want to get a 404 back, telling them that this is a resource that is not found. We do that by, in the end of our middleware chain, attaching a function to all calls.
Yeah. Because if we haven't defined anyone before, we will probably, the user is calling some URL that our application hasn't defined.
Yeah.
So we put that last, so to say, to catch all the others.
Yeah, so above this you have all the other the other use where we handle messages or users or whatever. Mm. But if I mean, none of those handle our request, this one will, and it will just respond with a status 404.
Yeah. Or if we want to present our own error handling page, we could do that. But
That's the way. Yeah, you will probably have a template.
Yeah, exactly. Template. But in this case, we just add the status 404 to the response object.
Yeah.
And it will send out a text in this case, but you could render a template or something.
And no need to call next in this case. We could want some kind of logging as well, because
we have the ability since we have it in the parameter list, but in this case we doesn't.
But it could be a good thing to be able to log our 404 calls so that we know if we have some false information out there. And then we have this one for handling errors in our code. Errors being thrown, basically, that we do not handle.
Yeah.
And we do this by, you see that the parameter list is quite different. We have four parameters in this case and only three in the upper. And so when Express finds four parameters in the callback function, it will assume that this is the function for handling errors. Mm. Even though we don't need next in this case, we should always have it there, because otherwise this will not work. And in this case, if an error is thrown, we will fetch it in this function, and we could give a 500 back, telling the user that something is wrong with the server, because that's the problem in this case.
So there are it's no built-in error handling in a fancy way in Express. So you use this guy, and could be, I heard some what do we call it, some bad things about Express, and people saying that this not error handling isn't that great compared to other frameworks. It's pretty easy, but you have to keep it last and stuff like that. It's but it works like this.
But remember, I mean, that is the important thing, that order matters in this case. You can't just like throw them in there and hope for the best. You need to think about the order, and you need to think about your next pointers in this case. So that might be a drawback, but. Mm. So moving on and letting go of the middleware for now, this is a kind of a middleware as well, but... talking about template engines. Mm. So when we are writing, the result of the code that we are writing is probably going to be a response to the user. And the response, if we're not talking about APIs, the response would be an HTML file or an HTML view. And putting HTML views together using like concatenating strings is a bad habit, because you will need to write more or less HTML code inside of JavaScript.
Yeah.
And we don't like that because...
We don't like PHP, where you for each inside and you for each...
You write PHP code inside of the HTML. And that is also, mixing things
we
up.
We want to separate things in. But this is kind of combination, this template, you have some some code stuff, but it's a template language instead of JavaScript language.
So we have a lot of options in this case. We are going to use a template engine.
Yeah.
And there are many, many templates.
Yeah, we have listed some of them. Yeah. Here.
And there are many more, believe me. Yeah. The template engine we are going for is handlebars.
Yeah, I think we used that in all our examples.
Yeah. If you have the book, the course literature for this course, they are preferring handlebars, and they have quite a good go-through guide of getting started with handlebars.
Yeah, and I think the documentation is good.
Yeah,
also.
It's really good. And the documentation as well, yeah. So we will not say much about it.
But. Yeah, that's a good book for this part of the course.
Yeah, definitely. So this is more or less what happens. So we have, from the model we are getting data.
Yeah,
and we're taking that data in JSON format or as a JavaScript object,
of course,
and combining it with a template. And the template will map properties inside of the template with properties in the JSON or in the JavaScript object, and it will bake those together and output HTML. And we could work with templates or different kind of structures that we have, like linking different templates together. We will probably have an example of that soon. Is there anything more to say right now?
No, I think we're going to look at the demo.
We're there. Okay. So, going back to Athen then. Can I open a terminal as well? Did that work?
Have you updated
Athen? No, has it crash? Yeah, no, I don't think so.
Because I get the same problem when I update.
Okay, let's start go with the terminals. Okay, so.
Oh, you had to prepare.
I think so. Clear. So this demo is also a part of you will find it on the course webpage.
Yeah, you have the repository link on the resource page for this lecture.
Yeah. So. Just to have a look, we have, like we said, the more or less the same file structure. We have the modules, we have the node modules, we have the public routes views. We don't have a lib.
No, we didn't need it.
We have the server.js and we have the package.json as well. And we could have a look in the package.json. It will say that the main will start by calling server.js. This is not complete, but you see the dependencies. We are using body parser, we'll get back to that. We are using Express, of course, and we are using Express handlebars as the template engine in this case. So first things first, you need to do an npm install. Now I've already done it, so it will probably be quite quick, but this will install our dependencies.
Yeah, and that was some kind of warning, but that's because I... it's empty descriptions and stuff, so it's nothing.
Okay, so
should we run the application
should
to
we
show
run it?
It
to show it first? Okay,
yes, so we know what we're talking about.
Should it be able to do that, right?
No, start
npm start. Oh.
Yeah.
So it will look for the server.js because that was the main. So it's up and running and listening on port 8000 in this case. Let's get back. No, not that one. That is secret. Let's get back. No. Yeah, here we are. localhost 8000, right? Like that. So this is more or less the application.
Yeah,
it's
great.
A really greatly styled application with the
nice
the classical gray background. It will be retro soon.
Lots of
time. You put a lot of effort into doing the styling on this one. So this is a simple to-do application, and I really think we should leave full screen because it could be good to see the URL as well.
Yeah.
So we have this to do's. So this is slash to do, and we will get a list of what we need to do. And we can make a new to do, and we will be taken to the create page. And this was what we talked about. So the browser will send a get to this address, getting this form back.
Yeah.
And now when I fill in something, drink more coffee, and click make to do, it will post to create and add drink more coffee. But when we look at this, the create isn't here, and why is that?
Because we have a pattern.
Yeah, that we actually
talked about
in the peer instruction, yeah. Right?
So you know all about it.
Yeah.
What's it called?
the redirect pattern. I forgot it as well.
PRG.
PRG pattern. Yeah, it's
easy. We have to think about it.
Yeah, because when post you say redirect it in Swedish,
yeah.
Post redirect get. So the post was sent to /create, and when this option was saved in the data storage, we got a redirect sent to the browser, redirecting us to the to-do. Mm. And we will probably...
So we avoid the double posting.
Yeah. And if we have a look at the network traffic, doing it again...
Yeah, you have to believe us.
Test like that. You will see that... Yeah, we get this created, found, and we get a 302, and we are going to do a new to the 200 in this case. So, yeah, we get a redirect, basically. Yeah. Nothing strange there.
No, so that's just a demo application, so...
Going back to the code.
Yeah.
We are requiring, and this was what we didn't see last... No. On the slide, but we are requiring the express, we are requiring the body parser, the express handlebars, and path, and that's built in...
I think it's a core module in Node.
Yeah. We are starting a new instance of the app, or the express. We are just telling what port we should be listening on, defining it as a port, and we are telling express what app, template engine.
That's define the template engine, what file extensions our templates will have. Mm-hmm. We are talking about layouts.
Yep.
In this case, we have a default layout, which we call main.
Main, and it's in layouts, and we have it here. So this one will be the default layout, and if we look in this one, you see that, okay, so this is simply a template HTML document, and we are telling that the body should go here and the footer should go here.
Yeah, so we can link templates in, partial templates.
So this is just a part of the documentation for the template engine.
So we register handlebars. So if you want to use another template engine, you have to change this according to that engine.
Yeah. Then we are starting to using those middlewares. We are setting up bodyparser.json, and this is for handling, in this case, are we sending JSON?
Why we have that, but it shows if you handle applications less. Yeah. JSON.
Yeah.
Maybe I had some idea of some kind of web API.
So in this case, you're probably just sending form data, right? Right.
Yeah.
From the post, and this one is for handling form data, because form data is sent during on this what's it called XML? No.
No.
I forgot that the MIME type for form data, but.
Multi-part something.
Yeah, like. It's not send as text HTML anyways.
No, so you have to parse it, and you use the middleware to do it.
Yeah. And then we are telling the framework, or telling Express where to handle or where our static resources are located.
We have to, and we have decided to use the public folder, and that's where we're using the path to get the directory name to put into stuff.
And it's important to note that this public folder, the folder, the public, will be invisible for the user. So in the client side, we can just reference style sheets, style.css like this. Style sheets, the style.css, hopefully. Yeah, and so it's there. It's not in the /public /style sheets.
No.
So that's important to note. Okay, so we're registering that as a middleware to handle static resources. And then we're saying that, I mean, instead of having a lot of routes, because in a bigger application, all the routes will,
there will be a lot of routes.
Yeah, yeah. And we need some way of dividing routes in a better way. And this is what you're doing here. So you're separating the home route from the to-dos route.
Yeah, I'm mapping the route URL to a file, a home.js file, where I continue to define all things I need for the home thing.
And everything concerning to-dos you are handling in the to-do.
Yeah, so I have in my routes folder, I have defined them.
So this is, and we will have a look at home and to-do soon, but so this is handling all the practical routes in the application. Yeah. And after that, we are setting up the error handling. So if none of those /or /to-do will handle our requests, this one will. It will listen for everything, and we'll send a 404 back. So if I try to write toopy-doopy-doo like that, we would get an error 404 back. You should probably have a custom page here. And
I think you have it in the comment.
Yeah. Should have an overview. And this one, if something throws an error, this one will fetch that. And the last thing we do is just start up the application.
Yeah, of course, when we start the application with the node, all these defines, so it will listen to these URLs. But then, after all the initializing is done, we can start the server, as we saw in the last lecture, I think, how we can use the HTTP library to start the server.
Yeah.
We here use Express, which is a wrapper around that, we could say.
Yeah.
And defining the port, and nothing fancy.
So this is pretty straightforward. Setting up middlewares, setting up our routes, and setting up error handling. Mm. So, of course, you could divide this into separate files, error handling in a Wi-Fi.
Of course.
This is just a simple example. So let's have a look at should we look at the home first? It's not much. So this is basically just handling the slash and get for the slash, the root of the application.
Yeah.
And it's just telling us that, okay, take the response, render a view, and render the home index. So if we look at the home index, it's this one. It will take this code and it will add it to the main layout where it says body, and it will send it back.
Yeah.
More or less, that's it.
Yeah.
So the home route is pretty simple. But this one we also instead of using this app.get and app.post, in this case we're using a built-in function called router.
Yeah, and I think that's a pretty new thing in. Well, maybe it's not so new anymore.
Years,
it came last year, maybe.
Yeah.
But you could end up with documentation or old articles where they are not using this router stuff. But we think it's nicer to use.
Yeah, it makes it more. It makes it a little bit prettier. I think you can nest like your calls like this. So you have
to look in the to do.
Yeah, we have it there. Yeah. So if we're looking at the do, for instance, on create, you see that, okay, so this route, the slash create route, it listens on get and it listens on post. So you can chain it like this. So all get requests are just sending back the to do create, which is this form for adding to do's. And where were I there? And the post will parse or get the text that the user sent in, request.body to do text, and this is because we have the middleware set up for handling form data.
So request.body is the form, and to do text is the input name on the inputs you had on. Where you write the
exactly the input field in the template.
So the body parser maps it pretty easy to us.
Yeah. And this is like, yeah, we have a model type, the to do, which in which we are adding our messages. We can have a look at that, but that's has not too much to do with this. And then we are, in this case, we are just redirecting to
the to-do. We're using the PRG pattern in this case, so we are redirecting to, because we know there that then we have created a resource. If the validation or something like that fails, we render the form again with an error, as you see, an error object.
So you get that text.
So you can look in the
create.
Yeah, you see.
Yeah,
we so have this is the template language. You see, it's like an if statement. So if we have an error, we render it.
Yeah, and you could probably do some styling to this as well. But
yeah, you could.
Okay, so that's more or less that. Yeah, don't forget, we need to export the router as well when we're using router like this. So you export the router object, this one, and if we look in back in the server.js, we can see that then we don't need to have any parentheses because we are exporting the function, right?
Yeah.
Or that is could be called as a function that are used in the middleware, really. So that is pretty much it. Okay, so we have a model as well. Should we look at that?
Yeah, we can look at the model. It's here. We're gonna work with this much more than next time when we're talking about persistent stuff. In this case, yes, the model is a module with two functions, one add and all, I think. So you see, the database array, is just an array with some JSON in. So we just push it into the array, and we, when returning all, returning a copy of it.
Yeah, and I mean this is how Node works. So when we have started a Node instance, it will run. And we will store everything.
This is
in memory.
In memory storing.
So if I refresh this page, or if I start another session and go into this page, we will still have all of those, but if we just close it and start restart it,
the memory is gone. So we're gonna solve that the next time.
We need some persistence, of course, in this case.
That's where the database comes from.
But this is a simple model.
Good for that. One thing with the views, we haven't talked about the partial.
Yeah.
We have a footer, like it's just a Creative Commons stuff, and if we look at the This is a partial, and we see we have linked in the footer during the rendering with you use that sign to tell it's a partial, so we can split our page.
Yeah,
and
so it's pretty much an include, just include that, so we could divide it into six different files.
Yeah,
and
as default, I think they are put in partials folder.
Yeah,
you can change that, of course, but as default.
What's the difference between 2 and 3 mustaches or brackets?
Well, the 3 is rendering HTML,
or is it the opposite the way around?
I
think it's opposite. So this one is protecting us from rendering code, for instance.
So you're rendering it at as you should see it.
And this is good practice where you output text which a user could have contributed with. It's good practice to have those free, because there is a risk that somewhere there is a script running, a client script that the user has injected in your page, and if you only use 2 brackets like this, then there is a risk that this script will be rendered as a script on the page, and you can like inject things.
And that's a kind of attack we will talk about later.
So always use free when you are targeting user-generated data, and you can use 2, for instance, in this case, when you're just including your own template because you want this HTML to be rendered.
Exactly.
So I guess, just to check if we're right, if we add a third one here, we will see that the output will be considerable.
I don't know if the
it's not possible to do with partials. So
try it.
Yeah, let's see. Something
like and we see that our
our rendered
worked. Yeah, that's exactly what you wanted to show.
So partitions couldn't be loaded using this one. So doesn't matter. Okay. So
That's a quick demo, and you have the code. Take it down, play with it, see how things change when you change the code.
Yeah.
And we come back next time to talk about more the model stuff.
Yeah. And when you're doing the second assignment, please, use paper and pen to think about your routes. What objects could you identify, and how do you want to create your URLs basically and set up your routes? You will have to defend those.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think that next time we
the persistent data, we're going into MongoDB and we're going to use Mongoose as a framework for handling MongoDB, and we're gonna talk about session handling, I see.
So are there any questions?
No, I haven't got.
Do we have any questions on the live coding TV? There's probably a lot of
well
I can't check them now.
No, we just
it's offline. I hope it's not, but yeah.
See ya.
See ya.
Bye.